Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. I'm Rita Kikiedozie. I'm the Associate Dean here at McCormick Graduate School. I'm also a professor, and I'm the chair of the Africa Scholars Forum here at UMass Boston's McCormick School for Policy and Global Studies. The father and son team that you were just listening to are Tumani and Siddiqui Diabate. They, the art history couldn't be better vehicles for us to convey the essence of today's event, which is our Ubuntu ceremony. I start with them to dedicate this to actually Balkisa, who is one of our program staff as well as our graduate student. I do so, Balkisa, because Tumani and Siddiqui are half Senegalese and half Nigerian, and Balkisa is joining us from her native Niger right now. So I just really wanted us to share the music of that beautiful land. Both Tumani and Siddiqui describe themselves as a father and son team who are what they call 21st century griots. A griot is a member of a class of traveling poets, musicians, and storytellers who maintain a tradition of oral history in parts of West Africa. And Tumani and Siddiqui are playing the kora. You know, the kora is what we call our African guitar, but it's, you know, a musical instrument that is made out of a calabash and bamboo strings. And, you know, that's the just kind of beauty of the music that that kind of creativity can produce. Well, both the griot and Ubuntu, which is our award ceremony today, they emphasize, you know, several values that we're going to try to embody, you know, in today's ceremony. They embody the values of community, sharing, affirming each other's humanity, and, you know, especially passing on our knowledge from one generation to the other. So today is the third Ubuntu Award Ceremony that we have held here at the Africa Scholars Forum at UMass Boston's McCormick School. The ceremony serves to fulfill all of these values. Importantly, for example, we use the award ceremony to recognize and celebrate the excellence in African studies, knowledges, and learning at UMass Boston and in our community. Let me also begin with, you know, our graduates. Today we'll recognize and celebrate six graduating students who have excelled with their learning as it relates to the study of Africa and or, you know, their own engagement and heritage links with the continent. We're also so pleased to recognize at least two of our graduating students with a special award of excellence. Last year, we inaugurated this award through the recognition of the work of a keynote speaker at the time, a doctor and ambassador, Fatima Kiari Mohammed, who is currently the ambassador of the African Union office based at the United Nations in New York City. Our collaboration then with the ambassador yielded the Fatima Kiari Mohammed Student Scholarship Award given to two UMass Boston Africanist graduating students whose research addresses critical issues on the African continent. Our Ubuntu ceremony today also recognizes the excellence of Greater Boston community members working on African community upliftment. This year, we are so pleased to recognize Mr. Abdul Hussein, who is an MPP and also the president of the African Community Economic Development of New England, pronounced as Acidone. In accepting his award, Mr. Hussein will present an address on an important topic that has engulfed us all this past year. This would be anti-Black violent policing and race relations as they pertain this time to the African immigration community. And so finally, throughout our event today, we'll bring you the music of Africa. Our final tune, Wait For It, is actually called Coronavirus Alert. And it's the work of a really talented Ugandan artist and politician, and his name is Bobby Vine. We'll talk a little bit more about him later on as we, you know, celebrate the year that we've been through. I know it's not much celebration, but, you know, let's recognize it for what it is. Let me use this opportunity to once again congratulate all of you graduating cohorts of 2021 here at UMass Boston, in the nation and in the world. I think it's been a special year, and you have what I feel is a transitional role, which will guide us, you know, to post-pandemic futures. Congrats to you all again. Well, now let me hand this over to our dean, David Cash, who will present some more welcoming comments, and I'll come back and introduce you to Hannah Brown, who is the president of PAGSA, who will also like to share some welcoming comments.
Wonderful. Associate Dean Adozie, thank you so much for launching this event today, but launching this event 3 years ago and launching the Africa Scholars Forum. I love how you always start these events and they are intertwined with music. I was listening to this podcast about a week ago that was about anthems and the importance of anthems and music that bring people together, that solidify passion and mission. And it's just fantastic that you intertwine all of these events with music, and exactly for how you describe it. They build community, and it's perfect, especially for this Ubuntu event. So thank you, and thank you, Associate Dean Adozie, for all your leadership in these trying times. You create community in a time where it's been really difficult to do that. So thank you very much. And this event is just another example of that. Congratulations also to the graduating students. What a remarkable year plus we have endured, but we have also challenged ourselves and succeeded. And there is a lot to celebrate when we talk about the accomplishments that we have made in finishing our programs, in being successful in our classes, being leaders in service. All of these kinds of things are so critically important at this time, and wonderful to celebrate, especially as we think about issues of justice, and as we're, you know, on the eve of the anniversary of George Floyd's murder, the kinds of issues that Abdul Hussein is going to speak today about, you know, cut really close to home and are so important to be hearing about the perspective of immigration and the intersection of that with state violence. And that's a really important topic for us to be addressing. So really excited to participate in today's event. And again, so much to celebrate for and so much to be thinking about and stimulating both our intellectual work and our work to change the world. So thank you and congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you so much, David. And we also want to participate in the celebration of you, Dean Cash, because you are Dean Cash, but also because of your, you know, remarkable support for the study of Africa at UMass Boston through the Africa Scholars Forum. You know, thank you. Let's recognize the dean for thanking him. All right, we've got the president of the Pan-African Graduate Student Association. Her name is Hannah Brown.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Ubuntu 2021. I'm so excited. As you've heard, my name is Hannah Brown, but my full name is Inglaifere Hannah Brown, and I am the president of PAGSA. PAGSA is the Pan-African Graduate Students Association here at UMass Boston. We are a graduate and advanced undergraduate student organization for Africanist scholars who engage in the study of Africa and the African diaspora. We are a collection of students from various schools across UMass Boston and are privileged to engage in scholarship that covers the economic, social, and political issues of Africa and the African diaspora in various parts of the world through our members' initiatives and from various perspectives. I want to say thank you so much for joining us today I want to say thank you so much for joining us again, once again, to celebrate our Pan-Africanist graduating scholars. As you can see, I'm so excited. I'm so excited because even with the trying times, we're doing this and we're keeping this going. And we do this with the understanding, especially as we believe in Ubuntu. You know, we're so excited to celebrate their scholarships, their achievements, and to celebrate our unity and togetherness as Pan-Africanists. And especially in these trying and challenging times. Because we believe in Ubuntu, which means I am because we are. And so I just want to say, I think the words of Barack Obama encapsulates this very well. He says, Ubuntu recognizes that we are all bound together in ways that can be invisible to the eye, that there is a oneness in humanity, that we achieve ourselves by sharing ourselves with others and caring for those around us. That is what we embody in this celebration. We're enjoying all our graduating colleagues to remember these words and continually celebrate how much we have achieved and will continue to achieve together after today, irrelevant of the times we're in. We're grateful to the UMass Boston community for our nomination once again for the 2021 Beacons Graduate Student Organization Award. And we look forward to attending the awards ceremony. And we are also grateful to the African Scholars Forum and to our administrative leaders, faculty, staff who are here and who constantly support us and encourage us in everything that we do. We want to say thank you for your continual support to the success of our students, especially Dean Cash. Thumbs up. Thank you so much. UMass Boston, we love you. Once again, welcome everyone to Ubuntu 2021. Thank you.
Thank you, Hannah. Thank you so much. All right, now to our first award conferral, which is to our community member, Mr. Abdul Hussein, the president of and founder of the ACEDOM, the African Economic Community Organization in New England. To introduce Abdul, we have Gifty de Bordes Jackson. We'll introduce him, and then I would ask Mr. Hussein to continue with his presentation, and then we will confer the award on him after his presentation. Thank you. Gifty, go ahead.
Okay. Mr. Abdul Hussein is the founder and CEO of the African Community Economic Development of New England, as we've been saying, ACEDOM. He has over 25 years of experience in community development, public policy, and nonprofit management. Mr. Hussein was a successful software engineer for many years before turning his attention and devotion to the African refugee community. His journey began when his homeland, Somalia, was engulfed in a civil war in the 1990s, leading to the influx of refugees into the country, particularly to the greater Boston area. He served as co-chair on the Boston Public School English Language Learners Task Force Committee, which is how I first came in contact with Abdul. A few years ago, I was working on my dissertation proposal and I introduced myself. We met on many occasions and we had many conversations about the immigrant experience, particularly particularly as it relates to students enrolled in BPS. Since then, I've been recruiting my participant through his organization. I also know that he's been working with a number of UMB faculty members, particularly those who are also interested in the experiences of African immigrant students. And so it is my great pleasure to introduce Mr. Abdul Hussein.
Thank you, Gift. I'm really moved by the introduction that you have just made. And I'm also moved, you know, the recognition that this committee actually recognized the commitment and the number of years that we have been very much invested trying to improve the conditions in our community in Greater Boston. My name is Abdulkadir Yassin Hussein. I was born and raised in Somalia. I was finished my primary and secondary education in Somalia. I became school teacher at age 16 and continued to go in school evening so I can finish my high school education. I actually taught from elementary all the way to middle school. I left Somalia in 1979. And the reason that I left Somalia because of the political condition at the time was not, you know, a good. It was basically we had a dictator that who came to the power in 1969 and actually really had, you know, created an environment that people were not able to, you know, remain in the country. I was very much an individual who always fight for injustice. I always really wanted to stand up what I think it's not justice. So I was really afraid that it would become a problem for me to stay in the country. So I decided to leave in 1979. Prior to that, I was really organized. When I was, you know, teacher at the school, I was the youngest teacher. And I saw that a policy that was made by the government, which I saw that at the time was not fair for our kids. And I raised my voice. I was reminded that if I continue talking about that may cause me, you know, into, you know, trouble. I was organized and mobilized, you know, teachers. At the time, I didn't know the word mobilizing or organizing or advocacy. I was just thinking about doing something incorrect. When I left the country in 1979, I came to Middle East trying to really earn some money. So I was destined trying to come to the United States. While I was in the Middle East, I was working, you know, in a company that was very much created an environment that was not safe. I was the youngest person among all the people who were working there. We were really have lack of safety. We were underpaid. We were really living in a very harsh condition. Again, I was really organized, mobilized, you know, doing a kind of labor organizing. I didn't know that labor organizing. And we really demanded, you know, to really address our issues. And it cost me my job. I was fired based on that, but never stopped me to stand up what I believe always, you know, which is a justice. So when I came to the United States in 1981, I moved to Boston in 1988. I was married. I have three kids. They're all born in Boston. In 1995, I finished my undergraduate at Wentworth Institute of Technology, computer science major. 1995, immediately I ended up, you know, hired by EDS, a software engineer. And I've, you know, working as a software engineer at the same time, my country actually had a lot of, you know, political unrest. Civil war was actually started in 1991. And it created influx of a lot of Somali refugees coming to Boston. I wasn't really aware about the needs for those community who are coming to Boston. I didn't know nothing about community development. You know, I didn't have no idea about the issues that the community families who have moved to Boston, they actually need to be addressed. Only one thing that I knew that I was very much interested in education and always trying to really help individuals who really want to help themselves. So I was doing at the beginning one-on-one kind of relationship every time I meet someone on, you know, playground, to see, especially I'm talking about the youth, you know, to see if they have been, you know, finished high school back home, or if they really, what they're doing, you know, in Boston, if they need to go to school or not. So I was really doing one-on-one kind of relationship. But while I was working my company, they asked me to do a community service in the suburban school located in Waltham. And I asked my manager if I could use my time to help my community. So that was the beginning of my journey. And they asked me, what community are you really talking about? which I shared with them, Somali community, who happened to become, you know, came in Boston as refugees, and their number are very big. So they asked me that, you know, what can we help them? The only thing at the time I knew was just computer software. I asked them if we could set up a computer learning center, which they commit $10,000 grant. And they also promised that they're going to give me, you know, computers and software and manpower who can really help them to teach about how they use the computer. But when I came back to the community, I realized the community was not very much organized. They came from civil war. They were not trusting each other. They were not really working together. And this is not something new to me. I knew that when I was even younger age, I was always waiting to see someone to lead me. And everywhere that I went, that Somalis who have been organizing as you know, leaders at the time, they were not very much, you know, able to, you know, achieve whatever goals they're trying to achieve, you know, basically being very much challenged by others, and they ended up doing nothing. So there is no success story that already before me at the time that anyone has an opportunity to serve an organization. When I came back to my, you know, employer, and I told them that, I said, I don't have any organization. What is the best way to really access this money? So they advised me to set up a nonprofit organization. So that was the first, you know, time that I was able to really lead anything in my entire life in terms of organizing in that magnitude. So I, the help with others, I was able to set up the first Somali organization. It's called Somali Development Center. That was located in Jamaica Plain. Immediately, we also got another $20,000 from the state. So we had a budget of $30,000. And we able to set up the first organization. And I was able to hire the first executive director, who was not able to do anything. A person who was fighting and saying that he's a leader. He was a leader back home. He wanted to set up an organization. I said to him, you don't need to set up anything. Everything is now is ready for you. You are the executive director. Here's the keys. Here's the budget for $30,000. Just do whatever you think is necessary to help the community. That person could not move anything. And I hired another person. Similarly, he wasn't able to move anything. Clearly, I saw that, you know, this place, you know, this, you know, organization is waiting for me. Immediately, I made my decision, consulted with my wife, and asked her that I need to quit my job and really accept this responsibility to run the organization. She didn't even ask me that. We were a very much happy family, three kids that we have at the time. We were looking to buy a house. We just thinking about American dream, that we are stable, happy family. I didn't know that what I was going into it. So my wife said, go ahead, just do whatever you think is right. I decided to step down my job and accept full-time the Somali Development Center. Within 4 years, the organization grew from $30,000 to almost $500,000. We were able to provide services. And I learned very quickly by just available to myself, to the people. I didn't know nothing about it. While I was helping, they helped me a lot. I really understood the issues that we had. And let me give you three stories that I want to share about the Somalis that I've met, the families. Let me take you back. I mean, all these refugee families who came from, you know, from Somalia, they came different background. 80% people who ended up come to Boston, and they came in a background of a nomadic, you know, a culture. They have never seen any structure. They never seen any city. They never really had any other opportunity. They have been, you know, many years staying in refugee camps in Kenya. Their children have lost many years of schooling. They had a lot of trauma. Regardless of all those things, they lost family members. Regardless of all those things, they were given only 8 hours of orientation before they arrived to Boston. That really prepared for them how they're gonna able to navigate and able to adjust life in America for 8 hours orientation. And that's it. The resettlement agents who was responsible for those families to really help them in transition, you know, to guide them how they're gonna able to succeed, were given 8 months for that transition. No accountability, nobody was really monitoring. And they have been actually put in many ways, a lot of families in a difficult conditions. Immediately, a lot of those families, you know, after 8 months, when it's the resettlement agency cleaned their hands, they became, you know, homeless. Immediately they become, because they could not able to pay the rent. They weren't able to speak the language. They could not able to communicate. they didn't really been put their kids in good schooling. They have not been placed in a good neighborhood. So immediately they ended up become homeless and they ended up going to shelter. So we became the resettlement agency. So my first 4 years of Somali Development Center, we were really managing crisis, literally crisis. We were not really able to do anything. Everything that we had in mind, we just put them on hold. All those families ended up, you know, going into projects where their kids are actually being enrolled, you know, underperforming schools. Families start, you know, breaking, very much confusion. So that was the beginning of their problem. So what kind of leadership then we need to really able to understand that magnitude of issues? We're talking about, you know, a lot of injustice. You know, we're talking about racial injustice, we're talking about gender injustice, economic injustice, environmental injustice, because a lot of the place that their children were placed was very much an inhabitable kind of housing. A lot of kids really immediately diagnosed, you know, a high percentage of asthma. So these are the issues that the community really are facing. In regarding the leadership now among the community, how the community is organizing and how the community able to really understand, you know, what's the best way to position themselves to help the community. And that was the problem, because we had the same people who have been part of the problem in Somalia, who actually part of the crisis that really created for these families to ended up coming here, are still demanding they want to be leaders within the community in this, you know, city of Boston. And they creating their conflicts based on their clan affiliation. Everyone really thinking that he's a leader for his clan, and he's saying, I'm not going to listen to another one. So that is the broken within the community. So the vision that we had from at the time Somali Development Center is basically how we can organize and unite the community and able to educate and really help them to really understand how they get able to, you know, solve their problem together as one team. At the same time, reach out and build alliance and power from outside. So that was the challenge that we had. So after 4 years that I've been working for Somali Development Center, I was burnt out, exhausted, and finally, you know, made a decision, you know, to stop. I actually exited. Prior to my departure, we were able to, I saw that the needs for the community was also evolving. And I saw that the community really need, you know, economic development aspects and empowerment. So we set it up. We actually had a strategic planning that we developed it. But then I left, you know, Somali Development Center 2000. I came back to 2002 to pick it up where I left and actually started again African Community Economic Development of New England, which is basically more economic empowerment. The approach that we developed through that process is very much transformational leadership approach. That we are no longer really want to work with the system. Now we're really working how we're going to change the system. And you can't do that unless you really have that transformational leadership approach, really empowering and inspiring the community and able to develop, you know, different type of people really able to understand and advocate and build the power that they need to help themselves. And ESODON has very much successfully succeeded that. You know, we have been started education as forefront. And I just want to give you three examples about three families who came as refugees, who have having to really kept the family together and had a very love before they actually came to Boston. Those families are, for example, a family of five, a father and a mother, and three kids came to Boston. And they have been through exactly the same process. All of this family became homeless, shelter, then ended up going into, you know, high crime area and underperforming schools. So one family particularly, you know, their eldest son graduated high school. The morning that he's supposed to go, to West Virginia, to start his first year of college, was gunned down by another kid who was 16, and he was 18. And that kid who was actually gunned down was another Latino kid who happened to be, you know, looking for revenge. And he mistakenly, misidentity, he just killed that innocent kid. The same family, the youngest son that they have, also been, you know, fined guilty, I guess now, has been accused that he's also killed another person for that one. So suddenly you can see that a family who were living together peacefully that came to America as the last place they thought they could build their lives, where actually ended up these type of situations. Another family is also, she came with four kids, happened to be the exact same problem. We when the eldest son being, enrolled Boston Public Schools, they actually put him ninth grade when he was thinking that he was 11th grade. And he never had enough schooling. And this is one of the problems that the Boston Public Schools were enrolling students, not based on their academic ability, but based on their age, chronological age. So when he was 17 years or 18 years, they feel shy to put him in a low grade. So they promote him in high school level. And what happened, it has been repeated for 3 years in grade 9, and he refused to go back to school. Once he failed that, he dropped out of school, he ended up in the streets, and then he had committed, some crimes, and then eventually been, put in jail. So when he came out because of trauma administration, he has been, detained by ICE and shipped him back to Somalia. So we have seen a lot of our young kids who came here in early age, a lot of them came in early age, who have been mistakenly, made a lot of simple mistakes. And they were not their fault, to be honest, because they were really been set to fail to begin, have been deported by ICE through trauma administration. And they went back to Somalia, which is still civil war. And these kids have no, really have any idea about how they get able to adjust it in Somalia. They don't speak the language. They don't even know the culture. They don't even have family members and have been deported back to Somalia. And there are a lot of numbers happen to be that. Another issue that we also have that the Homeland Security also targeted our Somali youth based on security, reason. And they created a program they called CVE, which they talked about control violence, the extremists, that they're really trying to profile our youth in a way they can really justify that, they are very much high risk. So they're profiling our kids through that process. So these are the issues that we really have been struggling as a community. Those issues and all other injustice issues that we're really talking about cannot be really addressed in a traditional leadership that we had in the past. A lot of our community members today, a lot of grassroots organizations among African diaspora are very much are not transformational leadership. They are a very much transactional leadership that they really want to work with the system and very much not ready to really willing to sacrifice and look in a way to change the system. And a lot of the system that we're really talking about, the educational system today in public schools, have not been designed in a way that they can really able to help and able to succeed our kids. So we have to really need to organize and mobilize. And what we're doing right now, for example, we developed a youth leadership program that we call Ubuntu Youth, which is very much addressing the issue of how they're gonna able to address the issues that impact their schooling. And they're looking for, these are the English language learners students, either former English language learner students or current English language learners who are high school students, who have been actually, so many problems that the district failed to provide adequate services based on their, their needs, are actually decided to really address the issue. And we're able to develop their leadership skills. And we partner with UMass Boston, Gaston Institute. And we have been provided, research, been certified as junior researchers. And they actually are the final phase of their research that we're hoping that they will come up some finding based on policy recommendation. So we are very much engaged in the system, how we're able to really change some of the system that's not really, the community is not benefiting. So there's a lot of issues. So finally, ESADON has been certified as a community development corporation, CDC. We are also trying to address the equity, in terms of economic equity, to really able to really help the community to create, wealth for future generations. So actually, one aspect trying to educate and provide, strong educational foundation to our children, at the same time able to provide, the opportunity to create wealth for them. So we do have a very small business entrepreneurs. Before COVID-19, we only providing 23 small businesses for technical assistance. Now we are actually providing technical assistance to 300 small businesses across the state, Commonwealth of Massachusetts. We also work in very much, first time home buying, training, and we're also trying to develop real estate development. We have in the pipeline, we're anticipating, to develop more than 450 housing unit, affordable housing unit that we're anticipating for the next few years, if we're able to succeed it, that can really help transform our community for that. So I think as ADON became a backbone organization now, we also recognize that a lot of our grassroots organizations from the African diaspora are very much struggling. We have seen a lot of organizations who have been established many, many years, but they never really had any opportunity to build their capacity. They're still infant stage, a lot of them. So ASADON are now proposed to really create as a pilot ASADON Institute of Leadership Development and Capacity Building. And we really want to help and able to provide support financially for our grassroots organizations. And currently we are working around six small community-based organizations from Somalis, Ethiopians, Eritreans, Sudanese, as well as Senegalese, that trying to really able to take advantage. And ASADON could really could provide all that in terms of development. You know, they don't need to reinvent the wheels as well. So I think that is, my personal journey. The meaning of community, it's really been evolved, even my understanding. When I actually started my journey, I was only thinking about community for the Somali community. Then immediately I realized it into more African community. And now I even increased it, the African descent. So that it's really ASADON trying to build bridge among African descent. And we are very much developed a working relationship with our other African diaspora communities from the Caribbean community, as well as the African-American community in Greater Boston. So that is my my speech. I very much, moved for this opportunity. I'm very much appreciated everyone who have been part of this process. Thank you for that. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Hussein, Dr. Hussein, Mr. Hussein. I'm calling you doctor because you deserve the the accolade. What an amazing story and of accomplishments and transformation. Were we in person, we would now officially award you with a certificate of excellence and outstanding accomplishments. However, because we're virtual, that certificate is still with us. But I would like to just quickly interrupt, this part of the ceremony and really confer the award of the Ubuntu Community Leader, conferred by the African Scholars Forum at UMass Boston to Mr. Abdullah Hussein, cohort of 2021. Thank you so much, Abdul, for your amazing work. You're just amazing work. I want to work for you. I want to work for you because I now see how to make impact on communities, something I've always wanted to do, but not known how to. So your message of transformational leadership, I think rings true. For many of us at UMass Boston who want to engage in community the way that you are to make meaningful impact. Once again, thank you so much for your service. I do want to hand it over to Balkisa, who will moderate some Q&A. I'm sure that our audiences have as many questions as I have. Balkisa, are you here?
Go ahead.
Yes. Hi, everyone, and thank you so much, Mr. Hussein, for a wonderful presentation about your trajectory and for sharing your knowledge with us. So I would like to open the stage for questions, so you can raise your hands or also ask your questions in the chats.
As we think about questions, I just have a quick one, Abdul.
Yeah.
So I'm really still very much, engulfed and immersed by some of the examples that you provided of your community and how you help them. Sort of the displacement in their lives when they first come as refugees to the US shores, and how your organization is able to impact, positively their lives. Can you tell me a little bit more about, and it seems like you have been working for many years, with many accomplishments, but can you tell us a little bit about how you think that the COVID pandemic has impacted your work on the one hand, and the lives of African immigrant communities on the other?
Absolutely. COVID-19 actually just highlighted the ongoing structural, issues that already existed in our community. It's not something new, but actually just, showed people how, structural, racism and all other issues that really created the problem. So our community very much, behind in many aspects about before crisis. And actually, Essendon turned crisis into more opportunity. We stood up and able to mobilize, our friends who are very much, our network, able to secure a lot of relief money that we could to share quickly back to the community. We created, we distributed, hot meal, for more, almost 20,000 hot meals that we have been giving back to the community. We also created an opportunity for other dry food, kind of food pantry that's still going on with getting help from the city of Boston. We have been actually working on a daily basis. A lot of our community members are behind digital technology. So they can't even able to, access those who become, unemployment. You cannot even file the unemployment, through technology. Today they need, technology, access for that. So really taking the risk, working in person at the office and able to really help them, the family, everywhere we can. We distributed cash assistance back to the family. So the community came together, and that's not only for East African community, the whole African community were united for this opportunity. And through that, we actually took advantage to strengthening our relationship of trust relationship that we had before. And Essendon actually emerged through that process as a backbone organization who could really reach out, and every resource money that we get from outside, we were able to share our grassroots leaders, organizations who can really share their community as well, because we cannot access the community the way we want it straight. So actually through that process, the COVID-19 helped us, all of us, come together and a very much close relationship. And we're able to really build that, working kind of network relationship with us, and able to save the community through that process.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that, Abdul.
There's another area.
Go ahead, Abdul, you're about to continue.
Yeah, I just want to say that I think in terms of demographic, our community very much, roughly around 70% are very much under 30 years of age. And even if you look back the whole African continent today, roughly similarly, that percentage are very much young population, are the youth. So, and historically, culturally, we are very much marginalized, our youth. We don't really give them opportunity for the leadership. We always tend to look to leadership, the elders, for that. And the problem today that most of the issues that very much impacting our youth, and they have no voice, and they have no given an opportunity to participate in for the decision-making process to be part of that. What Essendon actually did was shift of paradigm. We actually really recognize that and able to really develop the very strong leadership, programs that we aim to really cultivate the youth. and that we call Youth in Charge, you know, program. And both also, you know, decided similarly the gender equity. You know, historically, again, women and girls have been marginalized. We have been given the opportunity, and now the asset that we have today for the organization are the youth, particularly our young girls. So they are running the programs. Essendon, 60% of the staff are the children who actually succeeded from Essendon programming, who came at an age like elementary, remained into middle school, high school, and even college, came back now. They are now running the programs. And some of them, they even promoted into become a board members for the organization. So we are actually shifting the whole way of shaping the future, that the people who need that future are the youth, and they now have that future on their hand. So this is something of a Essendon, you know, model that we have been very much developed in.
I think Dinkash has a question.
Thank you, Abdul. Great, wonderful, wonderful kind of in-depth, particularly as it was noted on the community level. I have a kind of higher, we're a policy school, so I have a policy question. If you were to advise President Biden and Vice President Harris, what would be one or two critical things that would need to be in new immigration legislation that would help your cause and help you, help the folks you work with cause?
Based on what I know that, there's one way that people are fighting to increase the immigrant flow, immigrants coming to this country, but they don't really talk about it, you know, the responsibility behind that, you know, what is really, what it takes when family migrated here, and all immigrant community are not the same, you know, level. So particularly refugee families who are coming to this country, who are not equipped any way they can really able to help themselves, have been policy-wise, have never been, they just given opportunity to the resettlement agency for 8 months to provide these things, and they just clean their hands doing that. So I think they have to really attach the responsibility, you know, a clear path of succeeding those families, because the way I see today, a lot of refugee families, they set to fail. The minute they arrived here, they set to fail, and we blame them. Easily we blame them. So I'm not advocating just for the sake of increase the flow of immigrants coming to the country. I'm also advocating as a matter of policy, you know, the responsibility behind that. You know, they have to really create, you know, clear path of, you know, programming that will transition, helping them to succeed.
Right. Thank you.
Sorry, next we have
Yaku. Yes, hi, thank you, Abdul. Great presentation, and thank you for all the work that you do. Question I had, and I'm not sure if this is part of what you do, but how do you help immigrants, family immigrants, integrate into the community? Because I think a big issue with new immigrants, especially first generations, is how they integrate within their new communities, but at the same time keep their identity or their original community identity. That's something that I would say most new immigrants suffer with. Is there something that you do to help them balance that?
Yeah. I think the issue of integration and adjustment, you know, how they're gonna adjusting where they live. I think the issue, if we're really talking about the African, you know, communities, they are very much, you know, isolated in terms of they keep themselves as a community. They don't really very much allow to connect with other communities. And very much our children who are born here or even happen to became in early age are quickly, you know, integrating into the large society through that, through schooling, and they have opportunity, they interacting with, you know, other kids in the playground. So they are very much, you can see that. And even the system, the way it's set up, very much empowering the children, quickly and disempowering, you know, immigrants' parents who are actually feeling that they are, you know, losing the authority of their children as soon as they arrive to Boston or arrive to America. So parents, in terms of the language capacity, they don't have any programming that can really help the family, because language will really help them communication. When the families don't speak the language and they don't really have a very steady, that's why I said earlier, they never really had, you know, consistent, you know, programming to really help the parents to learn English language. They give in a 1 month class or 2 month class, and then they think stop. Then 6 months, a year later, we have another program. So they were never able to speak the language effectively as they should be. So the parents are very much, you know, put them in isolation because they can't speak the language. Where the children are very much easily to, you know, integrated because they're accessing the opportunity and the system empowering them very, very quickly. So I think that is something need to be addressed in another level, that immigrant community, they don't come as collectively, they come as individuals. When the community are not really developed strong programming that able to help the families to access and able to succeed, it becomes very much difficult for families to figure out how they get able to build that capacity. So at the end of the day, a lot of immigrant community, we left them alone and they have to figure out how they get able to, you know, integrate. So there's no kind of support program available that encourages parents, you know, to able to integrate. And you can see that. And even small businesses that are entrepreneurs, that we know, a lot of small businesses are very much ethnic oriented or very much, you know, kind of a country oriented. So they don't really have the opportunity to reach out and take advantage for other community who may be able to access their businesses. So their, you know, wealth may not grow because they very much, you know, aiming small percentage of their people based on how they feel comfortable. But there's an opportunity out there, you know, and there's something that we need to really talk about it, you know, how collectively we can address this issue, you know, together.
Thank you. We have a question in the chat and then a raised hand from Gifty. The question is coming from Ijoma. Ijoma, do you want to ask the question or do you want me to read it?
I can ask the question. That's totally fine. Thank you so much, Mr. Hussein, for the wonderful and inspiring presentation. My question is as regards collaboration with other African communities or organizations in Boston, if you are in collaboration with them or work with them, or is there like a unified or an organization that brings all these other immigrant communities from different African countries together? That's my question.
So, quite honestly, that we have too many African organizations that already been registered at the state level. If you just Google today, you will really surprise how many organizations that have been registered at the state, but how many of them are very much active that can really have a strong programming that can really impact our community. A very much, you know, small percentage out there who really doing the kind of work that we really want to do. What I know that we are working roughly around six African organizations who happen to be Somali, Ethiopian, Eritrean, Sudanese, as well as Senegalese community-based organizations who have been established a long time ago. Some of them the same time ESODON was established, actually never really evolved, never able to be developed their capacity because of what I said earlier, that, you know, strong leadership is missing for those organizations, particularly that transformational kind of leadership who really want, willing to sacrifice and able to really bring the community together for the sake of community interest. That has not been happening. So our collaboration are those grassroots organizations currently we are working, and these are the group that we're anticipating first cohort that we would like to develop their capacity once we institute for this leadership development and capacity building that a number of funders are now very much interested investing for that. But we don't really have other organizations among African community that I have been developed relationship with them, except those six organizations that I'm working with them.
Right, thank you. We have two last questions from Gifty and then Uchi.
Okay, so my question is in relation to those who are deported. So for whatever reason that they're deported, do you know what the outcome is for them once they're back in Somalia?
What I know is not that much information, but I know that a lot of those kids, because what happened is there's nothing prepared. The United States government just made the decision during Trump administration that, and they informed the Somali government that we're just gonna bring these kids back to you guys. So whatever they had a deal with the government, I have no knowledge knowing that. But a lot of those individuals, a lot of them are children who came here in early age, who have been, you know, failed schools because they did not really have any many years of schooling, ended up on the streets and eventually made very stupid mistakes that really being considered as, you know, they violated the law, were deported back to Somalia, and there's nothing was prepared for them. You know, there's no programming that's available for them. They have to figure out for themselves. So some of them, they still in Somalia trying to go from place to places, looking way to succeed. Others are their family looking away. They bring them back to other foreign countries so they can really continue their education. So they have a different outcome. Now we can see that, but none of them really have a desired outcome that I can see that it's really been doing very well.
Last question.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Hussein, for this awesome presentation. I really learned a lot just listening to you, and well done really on the work that you're doing. So my question really is related to integration. And I was wondering how immigrants, new immigrants get to hear about your organization to even approach you and engage and, you know, start to leverage any form of support that you have for them to help them integrate into society. I, for example, am from Nigeria originally, and I remember arriving here a few years ago to start graduate school here in Boston. And my first few years, really, I was really lost, you know, trying to find my way or figure out certain other aspects of life living in here in Boston. I just know that I focused so much into school because that's what I arrived here for. But there were also other aspects of my life that I needed to figure out. And I didn't have anybody to really help guide or direct me or advise me, you know, deeply, so to say. So I was just curious about, and also I'm also curious if you partner with for the high school schoolers, if you partner with the public school system, their administrative section, and also maybe for the universities, if you partner with the International Student Office, just for to be able to capture, but if that's beyond the
scope. No, absolutely. I think I can say very clearly now that we are very much partner with different higher education institution. We are partner now Siemens University. We're currently working with Behavior Health. It's a 3 years funding project that's funded by Beth Israel. We're actually addressing the mental health issues. As you know very much, a lot of our community are very much don't want to talk about mental health issues. They have been really has a lot of issues, you know, related with the mental health. A lot of our kids in public schools, even, you know, charter schools have been diagnosed, you know, as the special ed students, you know, either correct or incorrect. These are ongoing issues that impacting our kids. So we are actually a partner of Siemens University. We even decided to really share the cost. Any students who are graduate pursuing School of Social Worker could really get almost 60% tuition off through sharing by Esadon and Siemens. And we really want to build the capacity as individuals, as an organization, to be able to provide all the service that we needed in terms of you know, mental health or even case managers for that as well. Our small businesses, we partner with Cambridge University. the two staffs who are currently working, Director of Small Businesses and our Chief Operating Officer from Uganda. She came through that process, you know, and she joined the organization as an intern, and now she's Chief Operating Officer for the organization. We also partner Tufts University through that process. So we are very much encouraging our college students to really utilize Essadon as a way they can really achieve their individual personal goals, as well as able to help the community and make an impact. So something that we can encourage. I have to admit that we don't really have enough visibility that I could really go outside and talk about Essadon. I'm very much busy on just providing services for the community on a daily basis. So people are actually reaching out to Essadon. We're not reaching people. You know, I wish we could really have the opportunity, you know, to share a lot of things that we're doing outside so people could really know more about what Essadon is doing. But that's something we still trying to really improve it. And any one of you who listening today or part of it, I will encourage you a way to find to communicate with us, and we'll see if we can really find a way to develop that relationship and able to work together.
Thank you so much, Abdul. We returned to campus around August 9th.
Okay.
And August 10th, we are going to be in touch. Thank you so much, Abdul Hussein, for that really wonderful presentation and sharing of your experience and your work. We want to congratulate you again on our own, you know, conferral and recognition of you as our 2021 Ubuntu Community, you know, award. Thank you so much for your service. Thank you so much for participating today and sharing words of love, really, with our graduates. You know, thank you very much. And let's everyone give Mr. Hussein a round of applause.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Peter. I'm looking forward, you know, to develop that relationship as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Balkisa. And let's transition to you know, the next part of our event today. I hope, Abdul, you have time to stay with us. We are going to have a little musical interlude. But before the music runs, I do want to make a little correction with something I said earlier. Recognized Tumani and Siddiqui Diabates as Nigerian and Senegalese. That was incorrect. I got ahead of myself. They are indeed Malian, and I knew that. Who is really Senegalese and Nigerian, and who I dedicate, you know, the next musical interlude to being Balkisa, is to, you know, this next artist, and his name is Ishmael Lowe. And we're going to listen to his really classic tune, Tajabone. Okay, so let's you know, hear some music and then come back.
Momu
All right, is Abdul Hussein still in the room? Can we spotlight him? Oh, great, good. Okay, can we have the next slide, please? Because we actually did bring your certificate to the table. And if we could go to the next slide, please. There it is.
Thank you.
You know something, I'm not sure if you're familiar with Ishmael Lowe's music and that particular tune, Tajabone, but it's actually reflective of the things you were talking about. Ishmael speaks, sings in Wolof, Senegalese language. And what he's saying there is he's fundraising for the youth and the children, you know, of Africa, right? He sang this and first released it in 1990. It became a hit and has become a classic, but you know, certainly he dedicated it to, you know, the children of Africa and the youth of Africa. And I believe that's what your mission is at Aston. Yep. So very befitting in using it to award to you the 2021 Ubuntu Award for Community Leadership. Abdul, go ahead and say some words.
No, I'm very much moved. You know, thank you for this award. And I think, you know, I will share the whole community the hard work that we all did together and the recognition that you guys recognized is something that I would love to really share, particularly our youth who are behind all the success that we have actually contributed by them. There's no way that I can really get the credit for everything. You know, they're the one who actually did everything. I was just part of that success.
Spoken like a true community leader. Thank you again. All right, now as we move to our recognition of two more fantastic Africanist knowledge brokers, we'd like to present the award for the Fatima Kiari Mohammed Student Scholarship. Just want to read to you a little bit about the inspiration of the scholarship. You are looking at here, Ambassador Fatima Kiari Mohammed, who is the African Union Permanent Observer to the United Nations for the African Union. The scholarship award is inspired by her gift, along with a matching support, of course, from the McCormick Graduate School's Africa Scholars Forum and our Dean, Dean David Cash. It goes to two UMass Boston Africanist graduating students whose research is conducted on an Africanist issue. Our first award goes to Lindsay McMahon, who has just received her PhD, defended her doctoral dissertation with a dissertation title called A Top-Down Approach to Bottom-Up Development, NGO Implementation of Early Childhood Development Programs in Rwanda. She is advised, her dissertation chair is Professor Maria Ivanova. I'm not sure if she's here with us today, but to Dr. now, Lindsay McMahon. We are so honored to present you with the award for the Distinguished Fatima Kiari Award for your Africanist research during your doctoral dissertation. Lindsay, the floor is yours.
Thank you. But a quick correction, Courtney Sprague was my committee chair. Maria is obviously the director of the program.
Yes, of course. Well, I do want to everyone to recognize that and recognize then Dr. Courtney Sprague, also our faculty member in the Department of Conflict Resolution, Human Security and Global Governance, is Lindsay's advisor. I'm so sorry to not have recognized that earlier.
No, it's okay. She deserves the recognition. She read that dissertation front to back multiple times. I want to say, you know, I want to say thank you for the award, but I first want to start with sort of one of my favorite stories and kind of the driving force for why I do what I do, both regards and, you know, as a practitioner, social work practitioner, and also now, you know, a burgeoning PhD. But in 2007, I was like a baby, 23 years old, going off, joining the Peace Corps and, you know, kind of getting ready to move to the African bush. And, you know, I was going to Zambia and on a 4 a.m. flight and, you know, had issues with security and we hit traffic and like everything that could go wrong that morning went wrong. And I was leaving home for 2 years for the first time ever. And I sat down on the plane and I just burst into tears, you know, mostly from exhaustion, but also from anxiety and all of this. And this beautiful man sitting next to me asked me if I was okay. And God bless his soul, because I gave him my entire life story. And basically, and he was Sudanese. He said to me, you know, people are the same no matter where we go. And we're all just trying to figure out how to cope with life. And it's that sort of perspective that I took with me into my work in Zambia, where, you know, I lived very far from Lusaka, about a 3 days trip, in, you know, in the rural communities, in a mud hut with a thatch roof and no running water or electricity, and really learning the language and trying my best to understand the culture as well as I could as sort of an outsider. And in that role, really looking at the impact that NGOs have in low and middle income countries. And ultimately, I, you know, got my master's degree in social work and in global social work, and started to really think about how do NGOs impact individuals and communities on a very real human level. And that's what ultimately sort of spurned my interest in the PhD, and more specifically in the Global Governance and Human Security Program. And, you know, looking at the work that's happening in Rwanda, as you know, they have, there's a word regarding early childhood development called Tuyuake, and that means we make ourselves stronger. And that's sort of the country's approach to most things post-genocide, is, you know, we build ourselves up. And also the NGOs play a significant role in doing that. And the purpose of the research was to understand how does that actually impact communities from their perspective, not from the perspective of the organizations, not from the perspective of the state, but from the community perspective, because I think those are voices that aren't heard as much as they should be. And I feel, as someone who is, you know, privileged enough to do it, compelled to help tell those stories so that these organizations that are out there doing the work are actually doing work that communities need to do. And so I'm glad that, you know, it's great to, it feels great to be done, and it feels great to be recognized here in this forum, and forever grateful for, you know, all of my experience across the continent, which is, you know, primarily East and Southern, but it's where my soul is, and I'm glad to be part of this community, and I'm glad to be part of that larger community. And so thank you for the award.
Thank you so much, Dr. McMahon. thank you, and congratulations again. Our second awardee is, and I should say, Dr. Uchenna Nwangu. And her dissertation is titled Enhancing the Inclusion of Persons with Disabilities, a Case Study of the Twin Track Approach to Disability Inclusive Development in Nigeria. Uchenna is also a doctoral candidate who has now completed and defended successfully her PhD, not with the McCormick School, but with the School for Global Inclusion and Social Development, which is a school housed in the College of Education and Human Development. Congratulations, Uche Nwangu. I happen to be on her PhD committee. I want to congratulate her chair, Dr. Valerie Carr. If she's with us, we should spotlight her. I know I got that right this time because I was on her committee. But congratulations, Uchenna, you know, fantastic work you've done with this research. And please accept our award. And if you have a few things to say, please, you have the floor.
Thank you so much, Professor Edozie. I want to start first by thanking Professor Edozie and the African Scholars Forum for this award. I'm very grateful and inspired. My dissertation actually was inspired by my practitioner work back home in Nigeria as a program officer managing community projects. And some of those community projects focused on persons with disabilities. And I actually came into the graduate program at UMass Boston having this population in mind, because as a program officer, there were so many gaps in the proposal design. And, you know, as we supervised the implementation process for the projects, there were a lot of flaws. Some of them were able to amend along the way. Some of them were not able to, and, you know, so having gone through the doctoral program, I learned so much. And as I look back at when I was a program officer, I said to myself, oh, if I knew this much, I would have been able to do much more probably as a program officer at the time. But yeah, I look forward to getting back into the, you know, practitioner side of things in the future. With that said, I really want to thank Professor Edozie again and my committee head, Dr. Carr, and also the other committee member, Dr. Daftari. They really helped guide me every step throughout the dissertation process. And it was really difficult writing in isolation, I must say. It's different. I really miss coming into the school environment, interacting with my colleagues. I know, just having a different space to write and think. But I'm really glad I had some form of support virtually as well. And that helped keep me going, I mean, through the process. I hope to have more opportunities to continue carrying out scholarly research and work in Africa. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nwangu, newly minted Dr. Nwangu. Thank you, Uche, for accepting the award so gracefully, and congratulations again. Thank you both. All right, we have a next part of our ceremony. Now we'd like to line up our graduates who we will confer the certificates of achievement in graduating in an African study or in, you know, their work conducting, you know, work on Africa in the continent or in the community. And so we have six graduates. I'm not sure if all of them are here. So I would like, we could go ahead with your Opoku Agyeman, a very special student. There she is, a very special student because she has been my student in her master's program. And I've, you know, just amazed by, you know, the knowledge she brings to, you know, the classroom, her commitment and passion, you know, for Africa. I have said that I've called her Ya Antashawa. She knows. If you're Ghanaian, you know what that means. The Queen Mother. Ya, go ahead and accept your award.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for this award, especially Dr. Adozie and the African Scholars Forum. Having been a student of both when I was an undergrad and participating with this organization, it's just amazing to see this continue forward, even as I no longer hold a leadership position. So I'm just happy that this continues and that we continue shedding a light onto African works and literature that are contributed in the academic field. And yeah, thank you.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you so much, yeah. Our next recipient is Yakub Daha, who has also, he's a student, a master's student, an MA student in conflict resolution, in the conflict resolution program. I understand he's also a Fulbright scholar from Morocco. Congratulations, Yakub. We are very, very pleased and excited to confer the award of recognition of Ubuntu recognition for your achievements and your learning and knowledge as an Africanist scholar. Yakub, are you with us or would you like to say a few words?
Yes, hi. Thank you, Professor Adozie. Thank you, Dean. And thank you to the African Scholars Forum and the Dean's Office. And just a quick correction, I'm actually from Mauritania, but it's pretty much the same.
I am so sorry, not the same thing.
It's pretty much so the sorry. Same.
Thank
so
you.
Thank you all. And a special thanks to Eben Weitzman. I know he's not here anymore, but I wanted to say to thank him anyway. He's been really helpful throughout this 2 years and especially in the last 1 year. Thank you all and congratulations to all the award winners.
Fantastic. Fantastic, Yakub, and thanks for that correction. Mauritania, I know my African countries, Mauritania is different from Morocco, but congratulations to you. All right, we have our next award. Our next award is goes to a PhD student, not at McCormick, but at the, again, School for Global Inclusion and Social Development in the College of Education and Human Development. And her name is now Dr. Esther Kamau, because she also recently successfully defended her dissertation last week or so, and so is now a PhD. I believe that Esther Kamau is from the great nation of Kenya. If Esther is in the room, please can we have Esther accept her award and say a few words? She is not here, we are told. So let us congratulate Esther Kamau in absentia and congratulate her. All right, Lindsay McMahon is also a special awardee, but she's also a graduate. Getting her PhD in global governance and human security just a few weeks ago after she successfully defended her dissertation that she spoke about. So Lindsay, you can accept your award again. You don't have to say comments if you don't want to because you have already said them, but feel free.
Yeah, just again, thank you. Thank you to the Africa Scholars Forum and to McCormick generally for the recognition.
Thank you. Our next awardee is Uchenna, again, same thing as Lindsay. She is a special awardee, but she's also a graduate who just recently defended her dissertation. So she will be conferred with a PhD this graduating year. And Uchenna is here, still here. So Uchenna, you don't have to say anything, or you can. Would like to confer this recognition for your work in African studies and your linkages and engagement with the continent of Africa.
Thank you very much, Professor Dozier.
You're welcome, thank you. All right, our next awardee is also a student of mine who is completing her thesis. Her name is Bicherin Salome Nanga, and she is conferred with the Masters in Conflict Resolution. Is Bicherin with us? And she is not here, but we will congratulate Bicherin in absentia. Congratulations to you, Bicherin. Oh, she is here, there you go. I'm glad that she is here because Bicherin is also my student, has taken a lot of classes with me. Very bright Cameroonian student, hailed from Cameroon, and really brings a lot of knowledge to the study of Africa. Really excited about her thesis on the African Union security complex and its engagement with conflicts like the one in Cameroon. So Bicherin, congratulations on achieving your master's degree, and please accept our award of achievement, recognizing your fascinating work. You can unmute. You're muted, it seems. Now? We can't, it's not coming through, although it is showing that you are unmuted. Oh. Okay, let's just give a few seconds to see if we can be rejoined by Bicherin Nanga. And if not, we'll try to come back to her. Okay. Well, let's move on and come back to Bicherin. She says, I don't know what's wrong, but I accept my award and thanks everyone. Thank you, Bicherin. Okay, let's give her a round of applause. Thank you and congratulations. All right. Okay, our next awardee is actually a coronavirus alert. Let's have our final musical interlude by Bobby Vine and Nubian Lee, and we'll talk about that on the other side.
That everyone is a potential victim. But the good news is that everyone is a potential solution. Sensitize the masses to sanitize. Keep a social distance and quarantine. Stop!
The coronavirus is sweeping over mankind.
Everybody must be alert. It's a global pandemic we can never take for granted.
Kila
mutu must be alert. It's a matter of discipline and personal hygiene, and make sure you regularly wash your hands. Keep a distance from everyone. Report anything like a symptom. Serious fever is a symptom. Dry cough is a symptom. Walk with tremolo is a symptom. Itchy eyes and flu is a symptom.
Oh, moyo, we wanga, la vida kuhi.
a matter of life we can never take for granted.
Coronavirus is sweeping over mankind.
Everybody must be alert.
Uganda in the house. Oh, my goodness. You know, don't you just love Bobby Vine and Nubian Lee? Bobby himself, though, you know, he's an artist. He's an activist. He's a parliamentarian, you know, so he's a politician. And he just recently announced that he is running for president in Uganda against the longstanding 35-year presidency of Museveni in Uganda. So you really have to check out Bobby Vine. It's just fantastic. And his message, you know, helps us to end not just this event, but, you know, a year of coronavirus alert. He says, we are all the solution. We're all the problem, but we're all the solution. I'd love to end with, you know, Bobby Vine and Nubian Lee in their coronavirus alert music. I'd like to close this event and once again congratulate all of you who have received the awards today, including our fascinating community speaker, Abdul Hussein, our two Mohammed awardees, Lindsay McCann and Uche Nwangu. And our six graduates who achieve research and study in and about the African continent and their work and linkages with the African continent. Congratulations to you all. I'd like to thank everyone who has participated in convening this event. It takes a village, it's always about the community. You know, thank you to the Africa Scholars student staff. Thank you to the African Scholars Forum faculty members. Thank you to, of course, the Dean. And a special thanks to Rochelle Straker and to Jack Lee. And an even bigger, you know, thank you to Gifty DeBordes Jackson for her, you know, really special work, not just on this event, but all year. Congratulations to everyone. We will close now and adjourn, but I would love us to adjourn with some music. I know Rochelle knows what a hit. Give us anything African as we close out and say bye-bye to each other. We can actually also stop viewing the PowerPoint screen and let's see if we can have a gallery view of all of us.